morning, once again, happy Sabbath to you all. God is good.
All the time.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Amen. I bring you a greeting from Southern Church.
Amen.
I want to thank the pastor and the elders of the church for inviting me here to share the word of God with you. And not only that, to also share some experiences that I have with you in the area of health. So this afternoon, I'm inviting all of you to come back and then we share some good messages in health. I pray that you all come to see me again.
Amen.
If you are coming, say amen.
Amen.
I have captioned my sermon today, God is still in control, even in the valley. And I was listening to the testimonies that were being said. I said to myself, did they see this? Pastor, did you show them? Because it looks like what the sister especially was saying is what I'm going to talk about. And others have also said the same. We are going through ups and downs. Sometimes we get so discouraged. I am one of them. But this message today keeps me going. And I'm sure as you listen to me today, if you have forgotten that you have a God who creates a way through where there are no ways, you will come to know that yes, there is a God that you need to trust. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, your children have a sermon ready to listen to your words. It is coming from no other person than Caesar, a wretched sinner. I pray that, Lord, I stand before your people. Lord, you cleanse me from all iniquities. So that, Lord, you speak through me to them and your word to touch hearts and let them have hope. To replace the hopelessness that sometimes we have in us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
If you were following the text that we have read, these Israelites were in treacherous times. Their wicked king Ahab had been guilty of leading the people to worship the Canaanite god Baal instead of the Lord God Jehovah. As a result, wickedness filled the land of Israel and they were headed on a collision course with the judgment of God. However, in the midst of their sins, God still loved his people. Thank God his love never fails, as declared in Jeremiah 31 verse 3. During this time, Israel was attacked by Syria, their neighbor to the east. In this battle, God allowed Ahab and the people of Israel to defeat the Syrians and claim victory. However, in verse 22 of the same passage, we read that the prophet came in to inform King Ahab that the Syrians would not accept the defeat and would be planning to attack the Israelites again. And so he and his people should get ready and strategize. Church, permit me today to share with you some thoughts about this second battle. I think there are some truths in there that will help us in our work with God these days. In the Syrian army, I see a picture of our adversary, the devil. When through the power of God we are able to overcome him and stand with him, you can be sure that he is going to do a rematch another time because he does not accept defeat. His desire is to see that we are defeated in one way or the other. If he does not win in one area of our life, he will change his direction and attack us on another time. First Peter 5:8 says, is walking about seeking whom he may devour. We will see that this is just what the Syrian army tried against Israel. The consolation here, out of our church, is that just as the Syrian army were defeated and Israel walked in victory, we can also walk in victory with God on our side here in the church. Now let us take a note of some simple truth from the passage that can help us to know that the God we serve is still God, even in the valleys of our lives. Human beings are used to making assumptions, but unfortunately, not all assumptions are true. Some assumptions can be dangerous and destructive. And this is what the Syrians did. They made dangerous assumptions concerning the God of the Israelites. Since they were defeated in the first battle of the hills surrounding Samaria, they assumed that the Israelite God is only a God of the mountains. They therefore strategized to fight the Israelites in a valley where they thought they would easily defeat them. That was a costly and, of course, a wrong assumption for the Syrians. The devil also gambles in his struggle in the same way all the time. The point is, brethren, when we are on a mountain spiritually, we are hard for the devil to handle. Did you hear that? Church, did you hear that? When we are walking around with a shout in our soul and glory in our hearts, we are a force to be reckoned with. And so it is hard for Satan to defeat a spiritually excited Christian, as Nehemiah 8:10 says, that the joy of the Lord is your strength. It is the same situation the devil ran into when he attacked Job. His strategy was to squeeze Job so that he would speak against God. Unfortunately, all the devil was able to extract from Job was praise and worship. Amen. Do you do that? Or you speak against your God when you are squeezed? Can you imagine that, church? Job 1:6-22. When the devil squeezes us, and all that he gets is praises and thankfulness to God for his efforts, the devil is likely to stop squeezing. There is a saying in Ghana, where I'm from, in Akan, the language that we speak. It says, "Abonsam Nsabeji." If I translate that, it means the devil will get tired and in the end will get on you. Do you understand that? Abonsam Nsabeji. The devil, when squeezing and squeezing and not getting anything, the devil will let you off. It is said that one day the devil advertised for the sale of his tools. One of the tools, on that day of the sale, the tools were placed for public inspection, with each marked with a price. They were treacherous implements, and they included hatred, envy, jealousy, doubt, lying, pride, and so on. Now there was one tool that was set aside from the rest of the pile of tools. It was a harmless looking tool, well worn out, but very highly priced. Now, an interested customer interrogated the seller. "What's the name of this tool?" said, asked the customer. "Oh," said the devil, "that tool is discouragement. That's the name of that tool, discouragement." "Why have you priced it so high?" the customer asked. The devil answered, "Because it is more useful to me than the others." "And what's the name of that tool?" "Discouragement." "I can pry open and get inside a person's heart with that one, but I cannot get near him with the other tools. Now, once I get inside, I can make him or her do what I choose. It is a badly worn tool because I use it on almost everyone, since few people know it belongs to me." Are you with me, church? The devil's price for discouragement is so high, he never sold it. And so it was set aside. It is still his major tool. And he still uses it on those people today. Discouragement. It has been said that discouragement is a handle that fits all the devil's tools. The idea here is that Satan knows that when we are on the mountain, we are hard to get at. Therefore, he assumes that he can get us in the valley. It will be easier for him to defeat us. The sad thing is that the devil has been right in many, many cases. If the devil can get to you to focus on the negative aspects of any situation, he can get you discouraged. If he can get you discouraged, he can get you defeated, church. If he can get you defeated, he can steal the victory of the Lord right out of your heart. Let us be mindful that life is 10% about what happens to us and 90% about our reaction to what happens to us. If we develop a war, it is me, attitude concerning the events of life, then we are going to be an easy prey for the devil. If, however, we can learn to put into practice the lessons of Philippians 4, 6, 9, we can do ourselves a big favor, both spiritually and physically. It says, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. And finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. Those things which you have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do, and the God of peace shall be with you. That's what it says. Has the devil tried this trap in your life, church? Has he used the tool of discouragement on you before? I must be honest with you and say, without giving Satan credit, that discouragement works better on me than any other tactic the devil can try. Yes, my wife will tell you. She has been my backbone, but things go wrong. Things have come many, many, many times wrong. I trust God that God gave her to me. If he can get us off that mountaintop with discouragement, we will be easier for him to handle. There was only one problem with a serious assumption concerning God. To them, God was greater than they thought he was. We read in verse 28 that God sent his prophet to tell Ahab that God was going to prove himself to be God of the valley as well as God of the mountain. He assured his people of victory. Let me remind you, church, that God is bigger than your valley. I know that it is easier to serve the Lord when we are on a mountaintop. It is easier when we are excited about the Lord and about his way. However, when we go into one of the valley's experiences of life, he is still God. When we enter the valley of physical pain, he is still God. When we enter the valley of spiritual discouragement, he is still God. When we enter the valley of sorrow, he is still God. Regardless of the valley we are forced to enter, we will find out that he is still God. Yes. God wants to demonstrate to his people that he is God in every stage of life. He wants to be able to demonstrate his power in our life. He wants to show us that he is still God. That is why the Bible is full of many texts of promises that teach us that God is in control. Just like the following and many other samples, we know that God is determined to prove to us that he is in control of every situation that we face. Romans 8:28, it says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. 1 Corinthians 15:57. And thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. There's another in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 2:14, says, now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ and make manifest the Savior of his knowledge by us in every place. The last one is 2 Corinthians 4:17, for a light affliction, which is but for a moment, work for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. These are there for us to know that God is in control. For us as Christians, we see victory when we come to understand that Satan wants us to be defeated, but God has promised that we can walk in victory in spite of our circumstances. When everything around us suggests that we should be discouraged and defeated, God still says that we have the victory, as Romans 8:37 declares, that nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us in the church. In the final analysis, genuine spiritual victory is never a matter of victory of that which I am facing in life. Rather, genuine spiritual victory is simply faith in the promises of God. I am victorious not because everything is perfect in my life, but I am victorious because God is in control of my life. And he says that I am victorious. Therefore, regardless of the situation, I can rest in the promise of God. The battle may be raging around me, but it does not have to rage within me. While I may be in the battle, God has already won the war, and I am victorious because God said so. Church, I'm not promoting positive thinking, but I'm promoting taking God at his word and believing that he tells us in the Bible instead of what the devil or the flesh can say. More than anything else, the path of the valley begins with the ability to surrender to God in every circumstance. The people of Israel believed God and enjoyed tremendous victory over the Syrian army. They saw their enemy defeated by the power of God working through them. This is the place God desires to bring us to. He wants us to come to that place where we realize that he is God regardless of what we are facing. He wants us to get our eyes off our burdens or needs and get them fixed onto Jesus, the finisher of our faith, as recorded in Hebrews 12:2. He wants us to know that he is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the promise of God. Regardless of what we think about what we are facing, God is still in control. He is still God. Unfortunately, we sometimes live as if he is not in control. Is that true? Yes. We have to enjoy victory in our life valleys. Notice, I did not say won. Why not? This is because God has already won all our victories for us. We live in defeat and discouragement because we refuse to embrace victory by faith. We should never allow Satan to cause us to wallow in our valleys. We should never allow them to discourage us or to cause us to think that God is unable or unwilling to help us out. The truth of the matter is that victory is available all the time, in every situation, for every child of God. If so, why don't most Christians have victory in their life? That's the question. It is simply because most Christians are waiting for a feeling instead of claiming what God has already given them by faith. Think for a moment about some great men in the Bible who knew God had already given them victory in spite of what their circumstances were. So one of them, Joshua and Caleb in Numbers 13:27-14. It says, They didn't let discouragement take control of them. Rather, they depended on the fact that God was in control and He could lead them to victory, and indeed they claimed the victory. Samuel 17:37. We read also about David claiming his victory by relying on God's promises and focus on what God had done for him in the past. Can you think about what God has done for you in the past? And base your faith, your trust on that. And say God can do it this time. He said that the Lord had delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, would deliver me out of the land of the Philistines. In Daniel 3:16-17, when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego went into their land valley by having to face death because they refused to bow to the gods of the king, they also trusted and claimed the promise of God. They said to the king in verse 17 that, "If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning furnace, and He will deliver us out of thy hand, O King." There are many others, but church, I think these are sufficient for us to see that regardless of how things may appear on the surface, we must never forget that God is in control. I have no way of knowing what you are facing in your life situation this afternoon. Maybe that the devil has and is using his tool of discouragement in your life. It may be that you feel defeated and you are a million miles from the mountaintop. Let me just remind you that you're on the mountain and that He is still God when you are down in the valley. Whatever the situation. The secret of enjoying the mountains and the valleys is knowing and trusting that God is in control. If we can do that, then whether we are on top of the mountain or we are at the bottom of the valley of our life, we will always, always be on the mountain in our hearts, and victory will always be ours. When we get there, we will be hard not for the devil to crack. Even when Satan squeezes us at a time, we will be full of praise and gratefulness and worshiping our God as Job did. And he, the devil, will have no choice than to leave us alone. The first step in arriving at that place is learning to bring our burdens to Jesus by surrendering them to Him. Church, many of us have a Presbyterian minister loved those verses. Hoffman was born on 7th May 1839 in Augsburg, in Pennsylvania, USA. His father was a minister, and so he was introduced to Christ at a young age. He attended Philadelphia Public School, studied science. After completing high school, Hoffman furthered his education at Union Seminary in New Berlin, Pennsylvania, and was subsequently ordained as a Presbyterian minister in 1868. He worked for 11 years with Associations Publishing House in Cleveland, Ohio. Then, following the death of his young wife, he returned to Pennsylvania and devoted 33 years to pastoring Benton Harbor Presbyterian Church. As a son of an evangelical minister, Hoffman grew up singing sacred hymns, both in church and in the home with his parents. Hoffman loved writing hymns, many of which were inspired by pastoral incidents. He composed over 2,000 hymns and edited over 50 songs. One day, while calling on the destitute of Lebanon, Pennsylvania, he met a woman whose depression seemed beyond cure. The woman opened her heart and poured on Hoffman all her sorrows. The woman cried out, "What shall I do? Oh, what shall I do?" Hoffman knew what he should do because he had himself learned and experience the deeper lessons of God's comfort. He said to the woman, you cannot do better than to take all your sorrows to Jesus. I am telling you, church, you cannot do better than to take all your sorrows to Jesus. You must tell Jesus. That's what happened to the woman. Suddenly, the lady's face lighted up. Yes, the woman cried. That's it. I must tell Jesus. The woman's words echoed in Hoffman's ears. And he pondered over them and returned home. When he got home, he blew out his pen and started writing. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear my burdens alone. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me. Jesus alone. Hoffman lived to be 90, preaching the gospel, telling Jesus his burdens, and giving the church such things as what a wonderful Savior. Down at the cross, are you washing the blood, leaning on the everlasting arms, and a thousand more? My brother, my sister, do you have a burden too? Too big to bear? Why not take a few moments to tell Jesus about it? Take your burdens to the Lord, then lead them there by faith. Cast all your concerns on Him, for He cares for you. After all, He is still God, even in the life valleys. Church, in closing, I would like us to concentrate on hymn number 485. We must tell Jesus, for He is the one who cares. He alone can help us. Amen.
Our praise team to join on the platform to lead us in our closing hymn number 485. Church, won't we stand together and sing this hymn, a reminder that God is not only the God of the mountaintop, He is also the God that can keep us in the valley.